All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to have the first panel on corporate governance and sustainability perspectives from the boardroom. And allow me introduce our moderator right now, BC Adeyemi, who is the Managing Director of DCSL Corporate Services Limited. Please put your hands together for BC Adeyemi as I welcome her on stage, as I also read her bio quickly. Please put your hands together for BC Adeyemi. Now, BC Adeyemi is the Managing Director of DCSL Corporate Services Limited, formerly Deloitte Corporate Services Limited. She was called to the Nigerian Bar in 1987 and holds an MBA from the Lagos Business School. She has varied experience in litigation, corporate and commercial law practice, and has worked on various assignments spanning corporate restructuring, mergers and acquisitions, board evaluation, director upskilling, and other governance engagements. Prior to joining DCSL, BC was the chief legal officer and company secretary with a downstream oil and gas company and general counsel with a multinational dredging company. BC is an alumna of the Harvard Business School. Ladies and gentlemen, BC Adeyemi, and she will be moderating this next session. I'm just going to call on the other speakers and participants. We have Audrey Jo Izibo, who is the co-founder and executive director of Falcon Corporation. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Audrey Jo Izibo. And Audrey Jo Izibo is a serial entrepreneur with over 20 years of experience. She co-founded Falcon Corporation Limited with her husband in 1994 and serves as executive director, commercial operations, with principal accountabilities in the area of finance, business development, and commercial strategy. Falcon Corporation, an ISO 9001:2008 certified company, is a leading wholly indigenous provider of engineering, procurement, and construction, and natural gas distribution services to the Nigerian Oil and Gas Company. Now, Audrey also gives of herself in service to society and humanity as a partner and sponsor to various NGOs focused on improving the lot of widows, orphans, and vulnerable children. She's also an active member and has served in various capacities within Women in Management, Business, and Public Service, WIMBIS. A prolific writer and author, Audrey Jo Izibo has published two books, Uniquely Woman and Double Impact. Please put your hands together and let that be a double impact round of applause. Thank you. All right, on this panel, we also have the Executive Director, Heritage Banking Company Limited. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Mary Apobome. Now, I call her Auntie Mary because she is wife of a great senior colleague and mentor, Alibaba GCFR. But Mary Apobome is the Executive Director at Heritage Bank with responsibility for all strategic support functions, information technology, customer service and analytics, business services, corporate affairs, corporate services, general asset management and program management groups. Her passionate commitment to relentless stake raising in experiential top-of-the-mind service excellence and innovation continues to spur the tenacious value behind the Heritage Bank brand. She holds an MBA from the University of Lagos and bachelor's degree in theater arts from the University of Benin. She's an alumnus of the Lagos Business School, INSEAD France, IMD Switzerland, and a fellow of the Institute of Credit Administrators, Institute of Directors, and a member of the CIBN. Ladies and gentlemen, please make her feel welcome, Mary Apobome. All right, I've got two more to go. They are both gentlemen, so I'm going to make their own citations very brief. Please put your hands together for Tsitsi Mutasa, as well as Ambassador Joe Keshi, and I would invite both of them on stage right now. Ladies and gentlemen, please make them feel welcome. Ambassador Joe Keshi, and I'm very sure that I've missed the pronunciation. Oh, a lady, my goodness, forgive me. Please put your hands together for Tsitsi Mutasa. Forgive me for that. So he's one amongst many beautiful women. Tsitsi Mutasa is the managing consultant of Quality Corporate Governance Center, Zimbabwe Leadership Forum, a corporate governance and leadership development firm. She's an established professional with solid work experience in corporate and HR governance, program management, institutional capacity building, training, and research. As head of the secretariat, CC designed the strategy and coordinated research in 10 thematic areas as part of a process to develop a national code on corporate governance in Zimbabwe. Now, these include extensive research of international best practices covering corporate governance codes of over 20 countries. Now, she has over 8 years' experience in the SADC, EAC, IGAD, and COMESA regions, having conducted a number of scoping studies and evaluation on trade-related projects with focus on regional integration and trade facilitation. CC has vast experience at senior management levels, having worked for numerous international organizations such as the British Sky Broadcasting Corporation, EasyNet, the FTSE 100 Index. She has trained over 400 directors of over 40 boards and conducted numerous board performance evaluations across various sectors and industries in Zimbabwe and the region. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Tsitsi Mutasa. You're very welcome. And last but not the least, Ambassador Joe Keshi, OON, was until September 2014 the chairman of the United Bank for Africa, UBA PLC, and is currently a director and vice chairman of the bank after being appointed a non-executive director in 2010 and vice chairman of the board from 2011. He's the chairman of Afri Growth Foundation and director general of the Brasid Commission, a former permanent secretary at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and national coordinator, the Nigerian National Volunteer Service, that pioneered the Nigeria diaspora policy. He's a recipient of many national and international honors, including the Officer of the Order of the Niger. Ladies and gentlemen, our first panel is seated. Please put your hands together for them one more time. The CEO Roundtable on Corporate Governance and Sustainability Perspectives from the Boardroom. I now hand you over to the moderator, BC Adeyemi.
By once again appreciating Ini and her team, I would just like you to once again give her a round of applause. I think they've done remarkably well, you know, and consistently over the last 5 years. So essentially around this, on this panel, what we're going to be talking about this morning would be looking at succession, vested interest, fiduciary responsibilities, and compliance. But I'd like to take it from the point where Rehana had left off, talking about the ownership structure. You know, and I'd like to talk about that as it affects the entire governance structure itself. Also looking at it from the point of view of vested interest, you know, if how the ownership structure actually affects corporate governance and how it affects vested interest. And I'd like to start with Ambassador Keshi. How the ownership structure, how it affects the corporate governance, how it affects corporate governance, particularly with respect to vested interest on the board.
Thank you very much. I think it's obvious if you have a diversified ownership structure that it serves as a better guarantee for the success of the business itself, that where you have a total control by a few or just one individual. So in a number of cases, I think that the conventional wisdom is to ensure that you have a diversified ownership structure, you have a very diversified and strong board as well, you know, and once you have this, I think that you can be sure that a number of things will be in place, because such a diversified ownership and board allows so many things to happen more in the positive sense, that you don't have one dominant voice, you don't have one dominant view, you have a very diversified view, and there's nothing that strengthens a corporation or a board than to have some dynamism in which you can bring in a number of ideas for people and views for people to, you know, to help drive the business itself. So at the end of the day, I think that at least in our case at the UBA, we have a very strong diversified base, both in terms of ownership and in terms of the board itself. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll just try to make it a bit more real, you know, and give some, perhaps not mention the names actually, and I'd like Sisi to look at this. What would happen in a situation where you have a substantial shareholder sitting on the board, perhaps as the chairman of the board, you know, and when I say substantial, he owns at least 20-25%, and is the largest single shareholder, and is sitting on the board as chairman. How do you see such a scenario playing out? You know, I want Sisi to take that on actually.
Yes, you're right.
I was hoping that Sisi would take that.
Oh, sorry.
Thank you. I think once you've been called a gentleman, he was going to answer. I think in terms of the share ownership, it's critical that, and one of the biggest challenges that we have is the concentrated power. Once you have one person yielding too much power in any entity, it is a recipe for disaster. And unfortunately, this is what you tend to find, that you have one person who yields a certain amount of power sitting on the board. And one of the principles that we try to promote is that the person should not, ownership should not be involved in the day-to-day management of the business, first and foremost. But then there's also another dimension where we have disengaged shareholders. We have people who have shares in entities, and they do not exercise the power. They do not exercise their rights. So one of the things that needs to happen is we need more engaged shareholders. If you have your 5%, make sure that you see how you can pull that 5% together with other people so that you can demand a seat and demand a say on the board. So those are some of the things that I think we could start to look at, because if you don't do that, then the person with 38% will behave as though they have 100%.
Yeah, but on the board,
yeah,
you know, how would the shareholders engage? I mean, we're talking about the boardroom now. Mm-hmm. Shareholders have already appointed those who represent them on the board. And fortunately, unfortunately, one of those is also representing a substantial shareholder. And perhaps majority of the directors are representing minority shareholders. You know, how does that impact on the board and its effectiveness?
I think, here's the thing, when you're appointed to a board of any entity, it doesn't matter who is the appointing authority, your duty is to that organization, not to the appointing authority. And this is where we need to start focusing on. It doesn't matter who's appointed you, you must at all times do that which is in the best interest of the organization, not come to the board to be a parrot to the appointing authority. And I think this is where the independence and intellectual independence of individual directors comes into play.
Absolutely, and that's where I'll take Mary on. Yes, it's what corporate governance is all about, that you know you should come to the board with independent judgment as much as possible as a director. You're an executive director on the board. I'm not gonna put you on the box, but you know, I'm gonna ask you, how easy and how practical is that, you know, looking at your fiduciary responsibilities, and then also looking at the fact that you are, to a large extent, also representing, well, you are representing management. You know, is it possible, and as much as possible, do try to be practical, is it possible for you not to fetter your discretion? Is it possible for you not to fetter your discretion? So, for instance, perhaps management has some proposal to management, to the board, to present to the board, and prior to the board meeting, you have agreed that, you know, as management, we're going to vote in a particular way. And then you come to the board meeting, and there's some argument that perhaps might be superior, you know, to that you had considered before, but you have agreed as management that this is the way you're going to vote. How would you vote in that scenario?
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Thistle Praxis, Inni and her team, for the privilege to be here today. and you're asking that I speak specifically about my organization. Luckily, my organization is one where you have diversified shareholders. There isn't that one voice that consumes everybody. So while I do agree that it's important that you don't have that one person who can overwhelm everybody else, and therefore you have issues around vested interest and obviously the tenets of corporate governance, I would also want to see it from the point of view of who is this person that has this majority shareholding.
Supposing it's the managing director?
Supposing it's the managing, it's the type of managing director that has an overarching interest of the institution at heart over everything else, then it won't matter so much. But speaking about where I sit at where, yes, management comes with a position. You have a board meeting, and that position is put on the table. Luckily, on the board I sit, there are 13 of us. 10 of us are bankers, ex-bankers. So my chairman is an ex-banker, and 9 other people are ex-bankers on that board. And so you find that whatever management brings to the table are things that they are familiar with. So you don't have too much convincing to do. However, if they have superior, and I'll use your word, superior, if the argument against what has been brought to the table is superior, so it's not because the person or people that are opposing it are majority shareholders, but it's because it is superior argument, it's important to look at it. But if it is being looked at from the perspective of one or two voices that are loud because they're the majority shareholders or represent the majority shareholders, I'm lucky not to have that experience because we don't have that type of board or the composition of our board. We don't have...
It's diverse enough.
It's actually quite diverse. Quite diverse.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I would like to ask Joy now. Audrey. From the point of view of independence and independent directors, I mean, it's a model now that has been it's been adopted all over the world that, you know, as much as possible, let's have even more independent directors on the board. In the scenario that I had tried to paint, you know, where you have a substantial shareholder sitting on the board, either as director or as managing director, how effective, if at all, do you think the independent director would be? Some people have said, you know, and since we're talking about Africa now, we're looking at, even though we do not like to concede that certain standards should not hold here, you know, but given the reality of practice here in Nigeria, particularly, and in Africa as a whole, you know, what role do you think the independent director would play on a board like that?
Thank you very much. Are we on? All right, I actually was going to ask you if you would mind me speaking to her question, because I think I sit in the most practical space to do that, mm-hmm. and I will still address your question. Why do I say that? Because I run owner-managed organizations. Mm-hmm. So myself and my husband run some companies in the oil and gas industry in Nigeria, and we both are the substantial shareholders. We do have minority shareholders, but we are the major shareholders. And so it comes back to something I would have said to what the gentleman had said, the ambassador had said, which was the fact that it's governance is about having diversified ownership. And link that to what Mary said, that it's about the kind of ownership. Because for me, corporate governance succeeds in the space of personal integrity. What kind of people are we dealing with? And in our case, what we have done as owner managers is to decide what kind of organization do we want, how long do we want it to be in business for, and then take certain kinds of steps that we know will guarantee that. So first of all, our board is largely independent. We have 6 people, we're the only 2 executive members. In the composition of the board themselves, so they're not just independent, they are non-financial. Okay. And we have been very deliberate about submitting to their ideas, their suggestions, and so on, even recognizing that the OAS accountabilities at AGM level. As far as it goes with the running of the company, we do understand as business owners that we're not the embodiment of all knowledge. And as entrepreneurs, sometimes we get overly excited by our own ideas. So we actually need some very strategic people that can help us to think through the business from a long-term perspective. It's been amazing. This is 22 years and counting now for Falcon. And it's been amazing to see how much value our independent directors have brought to the table. So it's really about the persons who run the business in that kind of a scenario and what their vision is. Granted, I do agree with you that in real terms, if you have a dominant shareholder who also comes with a certain attitude, a certain level of thinking and ideals, and maybe his ethics are questionable, it can be quite an issue. But if we understand that in this day, every one of us in this room, we understand that sitting on the board is a position that can land you in jail.
Absolutely.
If we understand that, I don't think that's the domineering personality of anyone. You must make sure that your voice counts. You must make sure that you're adding value, or quite frankly, you step back. And I think this is where conversations like this help to build that. It's about the advocacy, helping the business people themselves to think through, why am I in business beyond the bottom line? How do I grow my small enterprise into one of the multinationals who will be celebrating the 100-year, the 150-year anniversaries? All right, so coming back to what Mary said, what kind of owner are you? What's your vision? And then what kind of people do you put on the board? Do you put them there for numbers, or do you understand what they're bringing to the table? And if you understand what they're bringing to the table, do you value enough that contribution to subdue your own, I own the business mindset, absolutely, and allow the company to grow?
So your experience, you found independent directors on the board.
Absolutely, value adding.
Okay. I'll go back to Prof and to the ambassador now and talk about succession. Succession on the board, and I would like to talk about succession to the role of the chairman. First of all, you know, what we have noticed also to say in this part of the world is that boards don't like to have that conversation, you know, that, you know, there should be a succession plan for the office of the chairman. And we just decide as it comes, as it happens. What has been your experience, sir?
I would answer your question, but let me just go back to the questions you raised among all of us about the role of a dominant, you know, chairman. To say that as we go through the question and answer, I keep what the concern is, and I just want to make this point. I don't know whether it's relevant here to say that even if you have a dominant character as a chairman or the dominant shareholder, I think most of the people who are establishing businesses today and running businesses are not establishing business to fail. So if they decide to come in with a group of people on the board to assist them, for me it's also to ensure that the business survives going forward, not just that because of his person or character or dominance. He's not going to ruin his business. He's just going to depend on the board members and the rest of the management to ensure that the business grows and becomes big and large.
Yeah,
put it simply, if you are today proclaim the African richest man, you're not going to collapse, allow your business to collapse tomorrow. You know, so I think for me, that should be a concern, but I don't think
Let me just try and put it in context that before you go and answer the question that I had posed. It's to talk to the point that perhaps sometimes the interest of the dominant shareholder, and I use this word very carefully, usually, most of the time, and I hear Audrey that, yes, you want to build a long-term sustainable organization, but there are times when, you know, you might be looking more to the bottom line. There are times when really and truly your interest will be in the bottom line, and perhaps you might not take other interest, you know, other stakeholder interest into consideration as much as you should, which is why there's usually some concern about having concentrated ownership on the board. That's within the context within, you know, which I wanted to hear views around.
Okay. Well, on your question, the issue of succession, I think to a reasonable extent, the central bank has, at least for the financial sector, the banks, I think there's a limit you know, of there's a limit of term limits,
for the chairman, 10 years
both for the directors and the chairman of the board itself. So I think in doing that, a good succession plan has been put in place. If it's not overthrown along the line, I think so far, at least in our own case in the UBA, it has worked well. Since I joined the board, we've had four chairpersons, you know, along the line, you know. So I think most banks too now do have that they have this succession plan following the rules of the central bank. And I think that also goes for the top management, the managing directors, and the rest.
So beyond regulation, and I'll just stay with you for a minute, beyond regulation, beyond the fact that the CBN has said so, because personally, you know, I would rather that we agree that this is what we want to do because it's right to do it. Beyond regulation, what's your view on term limits? You know, do you subscribe to term limits either for the for management or for non-executive directors?
For management, really, I've been at pains, for example, to understand why the central bank said, I think, 3 years for the managing director. Am I right?
10 years. 10 years. Eh? 10 years.
No. 3 years for the managing director. 3 years in the first instance, and it's renewable.
Five years in the first instance.
Oh, 5 years and 10 years. Look, I think it's reasonable, but at the end of the day, when somebody is doing well and can grow a business which they believe well, I just think you know, it should be allowed to, you know, to continue. We shouldn't look at it from the political view that you have 4 years as president and therefore the bank should have 5 years. Quite frankly, we are still growing in almost all facets of our life. And the more experienced people, look, we got to admit one thing we don't often admit in this country. We lack enough skills in almost all facets to drive a number of things. So when you begin to see people who are beginning to acquire their skills and that leadership role, and all of a sudden their tenure comes to an end, it is actually the corporation or the business that loses at the end of the day. Absolutely. So we need to begin to think these I give you an example. Well, this has nothing to do with, you know, I once took a governor to see a president of a university in the United States. And the guy is the fifth president of the university, that's the vice chancellor, in a university that is 120 years old. And the governor looked at him and said, I'm the seventh governor in a state that is 10 years old. So you can begin to see the difference. So when we talk about this tenure for those in you know, management, we really need to think through this very properly.
Okay, so particularly now when you have some managing directors having to leave the bank at under 45. Yeah. Okay, so Sitsi, I'd like to ask you, in the event that we do not have term limits dictated by the regulator, you know, how do you think we should handle succession to the position of the chairman? Because like I said, I still think that, particularly in unregulated spaces, that, you know, it's an issue that we dodge. So it just happens on us. Even when you do have regulations saying that he has to leave it after 10 years, how do we determine who becomes the next chairman?
I was itching to hopefully answer that question, so thank you. Mm-hmm. You know, one of the things that organizations don't do enough of and don't recognize is the strategic role of human resources. Human resources is seen as a soft, woolly, touchy-feely, and yet that is where the success of the organization rests. And in terms of the boards of directors, they do not spend enough time identifying talent within the organization, identifying talent within the environment. Quite often, a board goes into place and they see themselves as being there for the next 5 years or 10 years, whatever their tenure is. And during that period, they're not stopping to ask, when we leave, who's going to come in? Such that when that board's tenure comes to an end, the transition is seamless. They're not doing that. So from a CEO point of view, what you tend to find is the CEO is in place, the board does not actively, through an HR committee or through a governance, whatever committee they have in place, identify people. If we don't have the skill within this organization, let's start to bring these skills in. Let's train, let's mold, so that tomorrow, if the CEO wakes up and says, I'm leaving, we've got a smooth transition and the organization doesn't suffer. Now, and I think that in terms of the chairman, the same principle should ride, because you're not there for life. When we talk about boards of directors, your role is temporary. You're not there for life. So when you go in with an exit strategy. Go in with a plan that says, I am going to provide leadership to this entity for this period of time. And during that point, I'm going to make sure that I mentor the right people. Now, from a shareholder, we come back to the shareholder. If I can talk from Please. A country perspective, we have a challenge, especially within our parastatals and state-owned enterprises, where one minister comes in, dismisses the entire board, and then there's a new board that comes in. Mm. So you've got a board that comes in, 2-3 months later, a minister's changed, they go. It destabilizes organizations, and that is where we really need to start inculcating the right thinking behind what is expected of a board.
Thank you. Mary, let's look at CEO succession. You know, there are schools of thought for and against the involvement of the CEO in the process. Do you think the CEO should be involved in the process of selecting his successor? And if you do think so, how involved should he be?
Yes, I think he should be involved in the decision as to who succeeds him or her. The reason is a lot of times. Let me step back and start by saying that who succeeds a CEO does not necessarily have to be somebody from that organization. Back to the point that she made about who is the right person, is that right skill in the organization today? If it isn't, then we need to get that right skill from wherever it exists. Now, a lot of times you find that the vision, the whole makeup of the and the strategic intent of an organization, a lot of that lies with a CEO in an organization. So where he's not involved, I'm not saying he alone will take the decision, but where he's not involved in succession, in his succession, you find that maybe the person that would come on board would probably not be able to fit into the overall objective of that institution. So I would suggest that the CEO of an institution gets as involved as possible. Again, not to be the dominant voice, oh, it must be this person or that person, because then the issues around, again, corporate governance and ethics then comes in. Is this somebody that you are trying to push down onto the organization to continue your will, as it were, okay? But to the extent that the CEO in waiting can, or the present CEO can see in this person or this person the attributes of what is expected to take this institution to where the dream has always been, then becomes important.
I think they're quite concerned that the board and perhaps those looking on from the outside would have with that is, how do we then ensure the integrity of the process? How do we ensure that, you know, like you have suggested, he doesn't just bring somebody who would perpetuate his agenda, whatever that is. But I would like to hear you, Audrey. What do you think in this scenario? Should the CEO be involved? To what extent should he be involved? And also, in answering that question, once we have identified a successor, a would-be CEO, should we announce it? Should we let him know? Should we? What do you think is good practice?
Right. So my view is that certainly there should be CEO involvement, but I do think it should be as minimal as is possible, and probably closer to the end of the process when we've identified some strong candidates
so
for the role.
Be involved in the identification of those.
Well, no, I'm saying that there would always be options. Mm. You see, you're looking for value, and if we're not careful, we begin to look through a very myopic framework. The reality is that a lot of us, as leaders and as we get older, we're trying to replicate ourselves. But if we understand that industry is growing, if we understand that economy is evolving, is dynamic, you really need to question whether someone else can do your job better, taking a different approach. How do you have what it takes to take the company into the next 20 years? New ideas, new strategies, and so on. So I do think that, yes, certainly there must be involvement because there's a necessary handshake that must hold. The strengths of the existing CEO must be carried forward, but everybody brings something to the table. We also have to be careful that there's no agency arrangement, and I think Mary has spoken to that already, where a past CEO or an outgoing CEO is practically trying to still have his hands in and on the business through someone else. And this is really, really important where that CEO might also be a shareholder, strong shareholder or major, minor, whatever is irrespective. Mm-hmm. As long as he has shares, we have to be careful about that as well. Should we let the prospects know? I think so, because there's a preparation. And in that preparation process, I believe that this is where the true strengths are tested. Leadership is better envisaged when you have that information that this is what I'm being primed for, this is what I'm working towards. If there are gaps, you know how to begin to work together to build them. You can't just drop someone surprisingly into a position. They might not be quite as ready as you think.
Ambassador, I don't know whether you have a perspective on this, the CEO succession and the role that the substantive CEO, the incumbent CEO, should play in it. And also, just to throw something else in it, where we decide that we do not have internal competencies, you know, we've looked at it, you know, and we realize that perhaps at the growth stage that we are in, you know, we do not have that person that will take us either out of it or to the level where we are at. And we have to look outside. How do we handle those that are remaining in-house, particularly when they are already at a level where perhaps one or two of them already see themselves as stepping into that role?
Well, first, I'll be surprised to hear that some businesses do not have internal competencies. I want to believe that, you know, over time, they should have, they must have developed that internal competencies to be able to look across the board and pick one of them as successors to the outgoing CEO. Except there's something critically wrong, you know, or they just want to believe that, or they have very good sound fundamental reasons for wanting to pick from, you know, from outside. But having said that, I think obviously that the outgoing CEO or the CEO who should leave sooner than later, I think it's only fair to allow him chip in some words about who to succeed. For one, as a leader of the team over a couple of years, I believe he should be able to have identified a possible successor, somebody who could lead in his, you know, when he leaves. And I think that today, in a number of businesses, that has become apparent that as they grow, the younger ones, as they begin to look at the array of talents that they have, they also begin to identify possible future leaders of the organization, and they begin to grow them within the organization itself. So I think it does make sense to allow them have some, you know, some words, to chip in some words. Now, the extent to which they are involved might, of course, be a subject of debate. But quite frankly, I think all the time they have some, you know, some contributions to make.
Okay. After this round, we'll throw open to questions. But I want to dwell a little bit more on the fiduciary responsibilities of directors, and also looking at it from the point of view of this vested interest that we have spoken about. Sometimes directors find themselves in conflict of interest situations, and this conflict of interest might not necessarily be with respect to their own personal interest, but obviously with respect to nominee directors, it would be the interest of the nominating person or institution. Practically, how should directors handle situations such as that? Because, I mean, it happens. Tsutsi.
I think our challenge, and I say our challenge because I think as Rihanna adequately said, our African challenge. Mm. Our challenge in terms of corporate governance, if you allow me to take that view, is first and foremost, how are we appointing people onto boards? What criteria are we using to decide who should sit on these boards? That's the first and foremost. Why am I saying that? Because some of the things that we then battle with, you know, issues of succession planning, you know, the fiduciary responsibility of directors, the conflict of interest issues. Now, if our recruitment or our appointing criteria answers to basic issues of integrity, character, where we are looking past the letters after somebody's name, and we're saying, what virtue ethics does this person drive? Who is this person in the night and in the day? Those are the things that will then help us, because organizations have conflict of interest policies. But guess what? They're implemented and they're enforced by people. Now, I think there are many tools that we can use within organizations to ensure that our governance structures are right. But if we're appointing the wrong people to be able to oversee the implementation of these policies, it will not work. So everybody, you know, we talk about the independence of directors. And if you look at definitions of independence, you talk about material, people with no material connection to organizations. Now, look, a lot of us, you know, you get a board fee. So there is some kind of a material connection. But where the character and integrity of the leader comes in is, are you willing to say, you know what, I don't want this board fee because I don't agree with X, Y, Z. And the challenge is we don't have those sorts of people sitting on boards who will say, who will not rubber stamp wrong decisions simply because they want to stay on there. So we need to go back to the basics, get the right people sitting on the boards, and then we start to move forward.
Yes, please.
Okay. With the permission of our moderator, I just wanted to share a personal experience to make this real. A few years ago, I had a very decent, wonderful gentleman, God rest his soul, he died a few years back, who sat as chair of our board for a few years. Now, in that timeline, we had a venture capital partnership with one of the VCs who had a 40% equity shareholding and had three positions on the board, including that of the chairman, who was independent also of their company. Now, I remember we had a particular project we wanted to prosecute, and we had to make a presentation to get the investment decision passed at the board level, and they were averse to it. And so there was a lot of argument, debate, we presented all our facts, and the other two directors maintained their no, because that was their mandate. And the chairman said, no, this will apply. And they said, no, you have to vote with us. And he stood up and he packed his things and he said, you do not pay me enough to compromise my integrity. I believe in what they're doing, my vote is a yes. And that changed the equation. So it comes back to what we're saying, it's about the people. You can't tell me that I can compromise who I am and what I believe in because you said sit on the board. Now, in reality, this is harder to do. Yeah. It's easier to say. But then again, is the imperative for businesses and even governments to think through who are we putting on the board? There's some very nice to have names, but are they the people that would deliver? That is the question.
Absolutely. I totally agree with you. I'll just end on the note of compliance. You know, we should look at compliance, particularly in the light of what has happened in the last few weeks, a month, you know, with all the big names. And the question that some people have had to ask is, okay, so who's responsible? You know, we come here 4 days, four times a year. You know, we do not know as much as we should how compliant the organization is, but when the penalties come, you know, everybody suffers for it. So I'd like to start with Ambassador. What's your view? How responsible is the board as far as issues of compliance, you know, given what has happened in the last few weeks, like I said? What's the role of the board? How much of it, you know, how much of the responsibility should the board take?
Oh, a lot of, the board should take a lot of responsibility for the issue you have referred to, because my own experience is that on almost all issues, the board should be briefed and made to understand the consequences of acting or not acting itself. And so for something to be concealed, except of course it's concealed from the board for whatever reason, now that becomes even more serious. But on the whole, if the board is briefed and they decide to not to address the issue, then that's a different thing completely. But where the board is addressed, it's in the interest of the corporation itself or the business for action to be taken, irrespective of whether it pays or it does not pay the business. And I think this is where we must begin to applaud the regulators who stand up to ensure that there is some semblance of people at that level obeying the rules that have been laid down. No society, no organization can operate without obeying the laws of the land. And so once the board is aware, it has a responsibility to react. But where the board is not aware, now that's a completely different scenario. And I think the board itself should take action even before the regulators to decide or to penalize those who were responsible for not bringing up the issue to the board itself.
Absolutely.
I think in terms of compliance, one of the challenges that we have, again, it comes back to my appointing, the character issues, the commitment that board members have. I have worked with so many boards, and I could work with a board that's been in place for 5 years, and they don't understand their governance documents. They have not read their memo and articles of association. They have not read the various statutory instruments or governance instruments that relate to the industry. So now, when it comes to issues of compliance, how do you comply if you have not taken the time to understand those documents that dictate how you should operate as an organization? And then what you then have is almost a knee-jerk reaction. When issues of compliance then come up, because you're waiting for somebody else who has read your documents to then tell you what you should do, but you as a board has not taken enough time to understand. So you go into this tick box, tick box mentality to compliance. Do we have this in place? Yes, check. Do we have this in place? Yes, check. And this is not sustainable. We're talking about sustainable governance. And if boards, individual directors, do not understand their organization, do not understand the rules of the game in the industry that they're playing to, all they will be doing is ticking the box to say we do, and that organization will not flourish.
So it's not an excuse that we didn't know. It's not an excuse that we were not told.
No, because the documents are there. But what often happens is, I've taken boards of directors for inductions, and I give them a huge set, and then you say, have you read your memo and article of association? And then they will say, and they will scratch their head. And quite often that's a no, we haven't read it. And basic things, we've got people in the pension funds. In Zimbabwe, we're struggling because we went the dollarization route, and of course, a lot of pension funds were swallowed up, etc. And the trustees, when you ask them, what their pension fund rules provide, they will look at you like you're an alien coming from Mars because they haven't read the pension fund rules. Now, how are we expecting these people to provide leadership? So when it comes to issues of compliance, they're just ticking boxes. They're not well-versed. So it comes back to character and commitment.
Absolutely. Mary?
Yes, I believe that you should have people who have some level of knowledge or understanding of the industry, of the company that they're sitting at the board. That way, even when they read, they can understand. Because it's one thing to read and not understand, and another thing to read and understand. But in direct comment to your question, BC, I believe that it's possible not to have known. Because it's one thing. You are not management. Like you've said, you come for board meetings 4 times in a year. What I tell you as management is what you know, largely. Okay, so, but if you are very familiar with the industry that you play in, it means that for every regulation that is out or about to be out, you can make a call to the institution and say, hey, TSA, is being discussed. What position are we taking as an institution.
So shouldn't I do that as a matter of course? Shouldn't I always do that?
You should. You should. But the point I'm making again is, you will ask a question, and you will run with the answer that I give you. Correct? So it then tells on the integrity of the person, of the information that I'm passing on to you. So it's either way, yes, the board members today, increasingly, you are potentially going to jail if you don't get, I mean, you will not become management, but you need to get as involved as possible. You also don't want to be management so that you are not, you know, hitting each other in the heads and trying to take my job or making me feel like you are trying to take my job. But it's important that you can continually let me know that, Mary, you are representing all of us. It's important that as an institution, if we have a problem or we're likely to have a problem because some policy has come out, that we can know, we can discuss it, and we can be as transparent as possible. I mean, you can, and this now cuts across all sectors. We know what's happening in telecoms. We've heard what's happened in the FMCG. Obviously, the banking industry one is, everybody's talking about it. So clearly, the regulators are not joking anymore. And everybody, including the non-executives, have to get as involved as possible. Again, you are not management. Yeah. But it's important that you can speak with your management, let your management understand the implication of these decisions that we are taking. Again, like coming back to Heritage Bank, for example, like I said, 10 of us, 10 out of 13 are former bankers. So anything concerning the banking industry, indeed, some of the policies and a lot of the things, we just wake up in the morning and my chairman, who was a former CEO of Sky Bank, Mr. Kifemiwa, would have already sent us the link. So he already knows and questions are being asked. So to a large extent, there is a full understanding of what the sector is about, what the risks today are, and what the regulators and the body language and all the things that are coming out of the regulatory space. And so we do our best to abide by them.
I'll come back to you, Audrina, but I just wanted to ask Ambassador this question, you know, from the point of view of a non-executive director. Sometimes one gets this sense that, you know, directors are always, non-executive directors are always wary of asking too many questions, sometimes because they don't want to appear to be ignorant. You know, and so, and then there are times when they also take on this, you know, sense of superiority, you know, that, you know, we know it all, and so what's there to tell? You know, what's your experience?
Well, that has not been my experience, because at the UBA level, we, almost all the directors serve in three or four committees. So in any given week, actually, a director or directors are at the bank doing one work at the other. And that has actually improved their level of understanding and knowledge
of the business.
Even those who are not, you know, bankers, you know, so what's going on. Mm. And we ask very critical questions. And I must say, in fairness to the boys, they've been very forthcoming. And just like she said, you know, particularly... if you are like me, a consumer of information, as I call myself, as soon as I hear anything at all, I call up some of the, you know, not only the directors, but management as well to find out what's going on. And because these are things that come up almost in one committee or the others, at least I can say this for the UBA board, they are not just only very involved, but they are well briefed and they are very conversant with, you know, with everything that goes on. And we have very strong characters. I must say this also, you know, those who ask questions, and some of them have been leaders in their own field in the private sector as well. So, like, sorry, I didn't get the name. Audrey. The lady close to you said, you know, these are fellows, people you don't pay enough for them to sell their integrity or to waste their time. Not asking questions, so they ask. It could be, it does lead to a lot of discussions and answers from the, you know, from the management, and that's why I take the position that I really be surprised to hear that in some cases they don't know, except somebody decides that it's not something we should tell, you know, the board members. You know, I really be surprised at that.
Okay, so Audrey, I'll find a word from your compliance. Yeah.
My thinking is that boards and sitting on boards, performance on boards, has evolved. It's no longer the traditional sit back and be briefed every quarter. Those are not, in my view, functional boards. The role has changed. Two things I want to speak to. So one is strategy formulation or strategy review, being from the board level. But more importantly, incorporating the elements of ESG. So paying attention to risk management beyond enterprise-wide, but also paying attention to the key issues as far as sustainability is concerned. And then asking ourselves, what are the big questions that we need to be asking? The second thing I want to speak to is in terms of the committees on the boards. If we have our active committees, one of which is really key being the Risk and Compliance Committee, who are the members of that committee? Do they understand their responsibilities? Do they understand that they have the independent authorization to go into the company and talk to some key people and get some independent responses that should validate whatever has been presented in the boardroom? And are they doing that? So those are two things that I think are really key. And if that happens, you can't sit back and say you didn't know. Indeed, I believe that Mary, your chairman, must be related to mine. I'll tell you that because my chairman is Engineer Chima Ebeneche, the immediate past MD of Nigeria LNG. So he's also an industry player. And so you don't come with casual conversations. You need to be able to explain how XYZ, which we see today and which looks like is evolving tomorrow, is going to impact on the business. And so you're not surprised to get an email from him to the MD advising the management to sit down, review it, and do the report back to the board. The board must be asking the questions. It's not about leaving it to management, because like it or not, agency issues do exist. And then again, you have to be sure that those who are running the business that you ultimately are accountable for, they're doing the right thing. Compliance is easy to do, it like Titi said, is about checking boxes if we're not careful. But if you ask deeper questions, then we get underneath the surface and establish whether, as an organization, we're really doing what we're supposed to do. Boards can't be sitting back now, especially not, I mean, we have the SDGs now. Yeah. From the board level, we should be having the conversations around, as a company, how are we playing in this space? What do we need to change? How do we need to position? And then what are the big questions? You must be able to deliver those responses consistently to the full board and to the committees.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. And I think at this point, we'll throw open to the floor in the event that we have some questions. So if you just indicate show of hands, and when you do identify yourself, you please tell us your name, perhaps the institution that you represent. So I have already Rihanna who wants to ask a question. So we'll take the questions in batches of three.
Addressed to either Audrey, Mary, or Titi. Here's the question. This is a perfect world. And you are representing and sitting currently on boards. But where were the boards when we had a six-month platinum strike in South Africa? Where were the boards when MTN was fined right now in Nigeria for billions of dollars? And where was the board of Volkswagen when they reported in their sustainability and integrated report how they've applied governance, how they've had insight into the sustainability and integrated reports? So my question to the three ladies, unfortunately, the all women, is really, let's cut the bullshit. Do boards really understand their importance, their contribution, their liability, and that we as shareholders in those companies through our pension funds actually will keep them accountable? Thank you.
Thank you. At the back there. Yes,
maybe they want to take. I'm not sure who this is to, but governance scorecard reporting is a checklist ticking activity. We know that, okay? But could it be, and it's a question, could it be because of a lack of a clear reporting, agreed reporting framework? Because you pointed to two examples, I can point to 20 more in the last 2 years in corporate Nigeria, where management is under reporting. okay, and or it seemed, because again, agency interest, it seemed to be under-reporting until there's a slam of a big fee. And then everybody claims, oh, nobody knew about it. And if you remember the big Cadbury, so we had a lot of stories where management was under-reporting over the years. And I could list a couple of more. But is it a challenge between boards defining what the reporting format of management should be in terms of compliance reporting? Or is it that at the level of the boards, there is no clear governance and compliance scorecards in the first place? You know, so that's my question.
At the back there, at the back.
Can I, hello. My name is Emmanuel Epenyon. I have a comment and a question. First, I'm not yet on the board, but very soon, hopefully, after this session, I will. So my comment is around, I see a link between disengaged shareholders and corporate governance. I mean, one way to sort of demonstrate this is the fact that there is no apparent linkage between share price performance of a company and their performance on corporate governance. And we have very few responsible investors in Nigeria or Africa indeed. So I'm asking, you know, my question is, how do we, you know, improve shareholders' participation, if you like, activism in Nigeria, in Africa as a whole? Thank you.
Thank you. We'll take the next batch subsequently. Okay, so I think that I would have Tutsi and Audrey answer the first question, which is, do boards really understand their responsibilities? I think that's a summary of that question. Do boards really understand their responsibilities? I mean, otherwise, how do we have what had happened with, I mean, since you had mentioned the names, the names already around the room anyway, MTN, Stanbic, and I think last week, Guinness, and all of those, and she mentioned a few others. How did those happen?
Thanks, Rihanna. I loved the colorful word that we should cut out. You know what? My opinion is it's just weak oversight on the part of boards. We often have boards that are subservient, that are at the mercy of the executives. And how they get themselves in that position is very simple. You don't take enough time to understand the organization. You're waiting for the CEO to report, and that which is not in the CEO report, you don't pay attention to. Now, that, first and foremost, speaks to your commitment as a board member. How much time do you honestly have to devote to this entity? We have a challenge of people sitting on 7, 8, 9, 10 boards because it sounds cute to say, I sit on this board, I sit on, but what are you doing on that board? And it comes back to something I said earlier about the appointing. When you choose to appoint Tsitsimutasa to the next board, are you looking where she's coming from? What track record of performance, of delivery, has she got in terms of the boards that she's been sitting on leading? That's one. Now, we talk about the MTN, we talk about the Volkswagen. Now, Volkswagen had a challenge because at the time when the scandal had happened, they did not have a substantial chairperson of the board, which then made it even more difficult when the scandal blew up, and succession planning issues came in, there was no one to easily step in. But above and beyond that, the issue, you know, I think one of the questions that came up earlier was the power concentration. Having an executive chairperson is always a challenge. And I think, I mean, there was a Harvard Business Review that just came out on the 17th, and that actually focused on the Volkswagen, and they said Volkswagen needed more external and independent people on the board that would have probably helped them. Now, absent bonds is essentially what you're saying. The MTN, I don't know enough about that one to comment conclusively, because when you speak to different people, there are many issues around that one. But ultimately, here's my thing. I believe that if you're appointed to any entity, yours is to try to understand how you can add value, What is my role here? Why have I been appointed? Am I here to look at the finances? If I've been appointed for my skill in economics, I've been appointed for my skill in electronics, whatever it is, and then ensure that you exercise. You know, you've got a duty of skill. You know, we talk about the common law duties of directors, good faith, skill, diligence, and care. Identify, and at all points, be able to answer, am I applying myself? Am I treating this organization? Because one of the things they say is an organization can't do a whole lot for itself. It does everything that it can through the natural persons that have been appointed. So an organization is a legal fiction. You, as the person looking after the assets of this legal fiction, are you doing everything you can? Are you careful? Are you acting in good faith? Is the duty of diligence there? And is the duty of skill also being espoused? And those are the only things that I can say. Where we find that we've got disengaged board members or absent board members, I think we need to start going back to understanding whether these people are clear in terms of what is their role and how to provide leadership.
Thank you.
Ajay. All right. I agree exactly with everything you've said, Sisi. And Rihanna, thank you for asking that very practical question. Where were the boards? I'm going to say something. When Ini was speaking, she talked about the fact that all of us suffer from the umbrella description of Nigeria as the most corrupt nation, or where we've carried that title before, doing better but not great. However, you and I are doing incredible work here, and we're trying to do it the most ethical way. Why do I make that point? Because unfortunately, when the giants fall, every other person is colored in that space. And so if we're not careful, we take the few examples and begin to think that all the boards are functioning in that way. It is always such that the magnitude of the corporation that is involved or the government creates that sense that across Nigeria, we don't have boards that are disciplined, responsible to shareholders and indeed to the larger society. So I do think it comes back to one thing that we have said time and time again here. Who are the people on your board? And do they understand that business has to be operated under the framework of strong governance, ethics, and a commitment to integrity at all levels? Because if we test in the smaller spaces, we would also see some very good examples that are asking the right questions. So I'm always wary about generalizations, not to take away the reality of the fact that there are many boards that have issues. We have come as a country, and I think it's not a Nigerian thing. A lot of time, the average SME, by the time they're thinking of setting up a board, the first thing they want is where the big names. Right? They don't care if you come for meetings. They just want to profile a letterheaded paper and a website that has some really nice-looking names. And if you have some nice numbers or alphabets after, all the better. If you won a few national awards, that's great. But not necessarily those that will deliver value. So I think when we look at some of these things and where we have political appointments and things, it's an issue. Sometimes the board's collapse is because of this problem of a majority shareholder who is going the very wrong way. Absolutely. And anyhow you push it, it's not going to end well. The other thing I wanted to say, you asked a question about do the shareholders actually hold directors accountable?
Yes, I was going to ask Prof, to look at that.
Okay, you know, so I'll just say one thing, which is my view, that in a lot of cases, yes. Mm. However, there's a challenge, and this speaks to the issue of board evaluations. Mm. I think board evaluations, where they are being done, which is, I don't think, too much so, have also been elevated to the level of ticking the boxes. It's really hard to tell people, you know, you're just not meeting up, you're not adding value. Let's tell ourselves the truth. I love the Johari window. That exercise is really painful, but you get to hear things about yourself you couldn't have figured. I think board evaluations need to take that kind of approach, and more than anything else, they need to be elevated to the level of the shareholders, so that if I, as a shareholder, have put someone to represent my interests, I should be interested in the evaluations, be they annual or biannual, so that I can test whether he's actually adding value to me in the long run, and if he's not, there should be something in the contract that says I can take him or her out.
You can't. The law says you can't, actually. I'm sorry, Ambassador, I was going to ask, you know, a gentleman had asked, what's the correlation between corporate governance and the share value? You know, particularly, I think the question that he had asked is that how do you determine or how should we measure the performance of an organization, you know, using using its corporate governance profile? You know, should that or has that impacted on share value?
Sorry, could you come back again?
Okay, so to the regular investor, to the average shareholder, how should I determine whether to buy or sell my shares in this organization if I perceive that it doesn't hold through true to corporate governance tenants? You know, and in this market, you know, looking at Nigeria now, would you say that good corporate governance has impacted on share prices?
No, I'm not sure that, I'm not too sure whether, I mean, the way you frame the question, whether anybody who wants to invest, I'm talking of the Nigerian situation now, you know, cares much about the corporate governance as we are doing here. I think they just look, every day they look at the papers. if the shares are doing well, they go and buy, you know. And I'm not sure they read anywhere whether corporate governance has affected that or not. But to a large extent, corporations that are, well-managed, well-run, you know, definitely produces high, and that has high performance, you know, definitely produces a considerable profit. And I think that's what people look at. I'm just talking of the Nigerian situation when they want to, you know, invest. So, but in terms of corporate governance, I'm not too sure they pay attention to that. I'm not saying we should not pay or people should not pay attention to that. I'm just responding directly to your question to say that people don't look at that significantly when they want to invest. Maybe getting out of this conference, it's an issue that should be put on the table also in order to help, you know, a lot of people that you not only look at the profits part of it when you want to invest, but you also begin to look at how that profit is produced.
Particularly because we're talking about sustainability. How sustainable will this be?
Precisely. You know, so I just think that that's what, getting out of this conference, we should also begin to talk about.
Okay. Mary, I would want you to respond to the question about the governance scorecard.
Just a last saying, I think we've been talking about this issue of management, the board, and who knows and who didn't know. Please correct me if I'm wrong. Just to make the point, I think there is somewhere in all the regulations, because one of the challenges is that almost on a daily basis, central bank issues a lot of circulars that people must read. So it's not impossible that the executives do miss some aspects, not to talk of the board members itself. I just want to ask, correct me that, I think somewhere in some of the circulars and the rules, it is very clear that you could actually go to jail if something goes terribly wrong, not just because it was done by the management, but the board members also. Am I right about that?
Oh, yes.
So that makes it imperative also that board members, you know, knowing fully well that they're a step away from going to jail as a result of the of the mistakes of management, you know, just have to be alive to their own responsibilities as well.
Okay, so Mary, I was going to ask, have you answered the question about underreporting? You know, so do we have a governance scorecard? Have we pre-agreed that these are the things that management should report to the board on? And do we perhaps sometimes underreport?
You know, when we spoke earlier about is it possible for non-executives to say, oh, we didn't know, my response was yes. If there is underreporting. So there is clearly the duty of the board members to ask the questions. But because you don't sit on my seat, you are therefore going to be banking and working with or, you know, taking decisions around the level of information that I give to you, whether that information is adequate or is not adequate. You have trusted me enough to believe what I have told you. So a lot in all of this depends on management and the quality, therefore, of management to be able to over-report. Because right now, you should be over-reporting, not under-reporting. What does over-reporting mean? It means that today this is what it is, but you are anticipating that on the basis of this, this is what might possibly be happening.
happen. So you're already thinking ahead and reporting along those lines. But, you know, if you put me in a pharmaceutical company on the board, I'm one of those people that would be ticking the boxes because I have no clue what goes into making paracetamol or a painkiller. So I will be one of those people advocating for the right skills going into the right sectors. So I completely would agree with Sisi about the duty of skill, as she put it. If you put me in certain sectors where you manufacture cars, and I hear that, some cars, the brakes or something just goes off and cars are being recalled, they'll recall under those things would happen under, let's say, my supervision if I have an oversight function in that regard, if you give me that role, because I have no clue about that. So I will not be able to ask the right questions. Now, if I have a skill in that, if, however, you put me on a board, even as a non-executive and it's a financial institution, you will have to answer all my questions because I will know exactly what to ask. But if you don't ask the detailed questions, again, I'll refer to my board. Every board member is sending to, what's happening in JP Morgan, who is being slammed at Barclays, HSBC, we are getting those reports, those links on a daily basis as to what is happening worldwide. And yesterday we have so many circulars that are coming out on various issues. You have to go through each and every one of them. Because when they come for the examination, you cannot say, I did not know, or there were too many. You have to. And so it then behoves the board committees that are responsible for some of those things to be able to sit back and even begin to get interested in those circulars that are coming. Because it's on the back of those circulars that we will come up with the policies that would then answer to those circulars that are being sent to us. So we all have a duty, not just of care, but of skill. And there's nothing wrong with saying this particular role, I can't play it. I don't have the skill to be able to play it. But since I put it rightly, it would be nice to sit on 10 boards and be a board member. You know, when they're writing your profile, you're sitting on 10 boards and you're feeling very good with yourself. But 8 of those boards, you're really just putting the box.
I just think in a way you can declare yourself. Because if you are getting to the information about the banking sector, and if you serve in Australia, for example, and you hear that Ford has been penalized, are you not going to call up the management to say, are we in compliance with what's going on and things like that? Because you said it earlier on that there's quite a number of, so you have to find out, are we doing this or we are not doing this? Are we likely to run into some difficulties or not?
Yes, I will answer the question, but the point I'm making here is, when you send me a report, and I don't have the knowledge to interpret that report in a way that would enable me ask you, the right questions, then I'm lost. I will therefore take whatever it is that you are giving to me, hook, line, and sinker, because I cannot ask involved questions. Why am I sitting on your board if I'm going to have to then be going out to get independent opinions?
I'm itching, I know. Standing, I'm standing. Yeah. You know, I speak from a number of us, but when we talk about skills on the board, I would have a problem if I walk onto a board and I am seeing my bankers. I don't care if it's an investment banker. That is just an overload of one skill. You need balance on the board. You need that change agent. You need that marketing person. You need that IT person, the person who says, guys, this is where the future is going. You cannot have an overload. Now, the duty of a director is you have been appointed to a board because of a certain skill.
it is unreasonable. The reason you have a board of directors is because even within management, they don't have all the skills. So they're looking to the board to then enhance whatever skills they're lacking. Now, if you've got five bankers, what are they going to do about the change, the people issues, the corporate social responsibility issues? Because they're just going to be, so in terms of, I work with boards and I struggle when I see too many, we have boards, five lawyers, what are they doing? Five accountants, because lawyers, all they're doing is they're talking, they're hearing their voices, they like to hear their own voices, and they're not doing anything. So, sorry to the lawyers. In the house. Let us go for balance of skills on the board. We need that.
Ask the question. His question was more around, could the issue be that there is no reporting format? And I know you guys have been doing great work in terms of how trying to build those frameworks. I think that's a very important project. I think that the advocacy around that will help a lot. However, I was reading, it was a presentation that Professor Colson Thomas made at the IOD conference in London last year. And he asked some really, really great questions. And one of the things he said is that he hopes we are not substituting reporting formats for actual information, by which he said they're getting more complex, nobody's understanding them, and so guess what, it becomes another box ticking. And I tell you that, when I think about my company, we moved to the IFRS reporting framework about 3 years ago now, going to 4. The first time I saw the report, audited account, I was like, yeah, right. It was a whole new process of educating myself, asking the questions, why are we treating this like this, why are we doing that? I'm able to do that because I'm in management as well. Honestly, minus the key financial skills that we have on the board, I think that other directors would struggle. So just to say that reporting formats are great, they will set the tone, but as we're advocating those, let's not be trying to complicate things, because if the actual users of the information are put off from reading them, it would actually be destroying value and making the system work worse.
At the end, I would like to say that some of the things I was taking away from here, that ultimately at the end of the day, it's not about the reporting or the lack of it, because we have to place a lot of emphasis on those who will be reported anyway. You know, so what are the process of appointing them? What's the process of determining whether or not they're the right people? What is the level of integrity that they have? Beyond the skills that they bring to the board, are they people that we can go to sleep when they say, okay, this is what it is, you know, without us being too careful as to, have they given us enough information? Are they on the report that we actually do trust them? So thank you very much. You've all been wonderful, and the others have been wonderful as well.
Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for this wonderful panel. Please make it loud, make it loud. Okay, we'll ask for them to...
And to our moderator, BCRDME, Managing Director, DCSL Corporate Services Limited, thank you so much. Let's celebrate the participants, Audrey Joe Ezigbo, Mary Akpobome, Tsitsi Mutazan, Ambassador Joe Keshi. Please let's put our hands together for them one more time. We'll have more question and answer sessions as we go along, but let's take advantage of whatever opportunities we have to interact and to mingle and, you know, to have this networking sessions where we can engage some of the speakers one-on-one. Now, I've been asked by the organizers to give a 10-minute break so that if you need to use the bathroom, you can do so. If you need to grab tea, you can do so as well. But just before we do that, we have here present, and earlier the convener recognized his presence, but would like to specially again recognize the presence of our keynote speaker, Professor Mervyn King, who is a former judge of the Supreme Court of South Africa, the former chairman of the United Nations Committee on Governance and Oversight, and the chair King Committee on Corporate Governance. Please, let's celebrate Professor Mervyn King. I've been asked to remind you that Professor King will be delivering his keynote address tomorrow morning. So whatever you have to do to get here on time, please do it. If you need to get a room here at a co-hotel, feel free. I don't know if there are discounts, but whatever you need to do to get here early tomorrow, please come early because he'll be delivering his keynote address tomorrow. So I think we can proceed on our 10-minute break. It will be 10 minutes, we can assure you.
My name is Ambassador Joe Keshi, Vice Chairman of UBA and Chairman of Africa Growth, Director General Brace Commission. I'm attending this conference, I think, for the fourth or the fifth time, really, and I'm glad to be here again, more because I believe in the work that the organization is doing in terms of trying to draw attention to the essence of corporate governance and the sustainability of the responsibility of those in running businesses to affect our lives and the way we live. Well, over the years, I think a lot has improved as compared to what was being done in the last couple of years, but there's still a long way to go. The successor to the Millennium Development Goal talked about the eradication of poverty and talked of the fact that we need to scale up on issues of education, the environment, health, and the rest of it, in order to improve human, you know, life and the lives of the people in given states. And in a country like ours, where poverty is still enormous and huge, we just got to realize that government alone cannot do it. And so we will need the involvement of corporations or corporate bodies with large hearts, you know, to step in and do as much as they can. They need to realize that they would gain more. They will make more profits when you have a healthy society, when you have an educated society. Because you see, when you have a healthy society, not only do people live long, when you have an educated society, you have a society that appreciates the need to save, to invest, and in doing that, and of course, to spend, which means that everybody, when you put these three together, you will see that companies and corporations will make more profits than existing in an environment ridden by poverty. So it's very essential that we continue to emphasize the essence of good governance, not just at the governmental level, but good governance also at the corporation level. The governance that not only believes in profit, but in understanding that you also need to use some of that profit to improve the environment in which you live in. More because government alone cannot do it, and you need to help bring up the people and improve your business. And that's where the issue of sustainability also comes in.
I'm Tsitsi Mtesa. I am the managing consultant of Zimbabwe Leadership Forum, which is a corporate governance and leadership development consultancy based in Zimbabwe. I'm attending this conference for the very first time in Nigeria, and it's exciting. There's a lot of positive energy. There's a lot of visionary energy around, because everybody's looking to the future. Everybody's got a very long-term view of what they want to come out. And in terms of the topic, corporate social responsibility and governance for sustainability, you cannot separate the two. All entities, all organizations, they're built, or at least they're started, with the vision that they will carry on. They will transcend generations. The African dimension, or the African experience, has been the here today, gone tomorrow. we're not putting in the necessary structures within organizations. We're not adhering to the right principles, sustainability practices, sustainable business practices, to ensure that when we start an organization, it will see past us. So this conference and the information that we're picking up, and just the presentations so far, all of them are pointing to the need to build within the organizational strategy issues of corporate governance, issues of sustainability. Corporate governance and business sustainability cannot be optional add-ons. They are the heart of the business, because otherwise the business goes nowhere. You know, I don't think it's so much that we're not aware of it, because you see, if you look at the African domain, one of the sources of corporate social responsibility, culture, values, you've got areas in certain African communities that are, these are sacred areas. They can't be, so issues of corporate social responsibility, it's just that how we're packaging them and how we are presenting them to people, we're not contextualizing them, such that when you're speaking to somebody in Nigeria, when you're speaking to somebody in Kenya, you're not talking about, you know, fancy stuff that they cannot relate to. What we're simply talking about is we need to do today that which enables our children, our children's children, to be able to benefit. So when we're using resources, we need to think about, how am I using this resource? Am I not depleting? You know, when I'm going into the forest to get my firewood, what am I doing? Am I uprooting the tree? You know, such that 10 years from now, my children cannot go into that forest. What am I doing when I'm planting? You know, am I going right by the river? And am I, what am I, my actions, how are they? So if we take things out of context, or if we don't contextualize the corporate social responsibility, it can then lead us, you know, in the African community to think, no, it's the developing countries. They're the ones, you know, with the massive factories. They're the ones, you know, with the pollution issues. And yet, right here, there are things, unsustainable business practices that we are taking part in that we're not aware of. Remuneration, for example. It's a basic standard practice. We, in some entities, we're not matching the remuneration to the capacity of the organization to pay. You know, we're thinking about my salary, we're not thinking about the organization being able to go forward. So it's all these other things. And then there's also a challenge where we're not able to directly link corporate social responsibility initiatives to profitability within the organization. We see CSR as a drain. We see it as an expense, and yet it is actually an investment, because you're not investing in today, but you're investing in the future. You're investing in the opportunity or the capacity of this organization, whatever organization it is, to be able. So if you're contributing to a school, what you're doing is, we value education. We want to ensure that in 10 years' time, our children will have somewhere to go to school. If you're investing in maybe, say, clean water, what you're saying is, I want to ensure that the health of the people. So those are the things. So because we are taking CSR and we're blowing it out of proportion, and we're not contextualizing to say, you as an individual, not as so-and-so incorporated, as Jennifer, what are the things that you could do to ensure a better environment, a better life for generations to come? So those are the things. So I think if we're talking here for people to understand it, because, you know, you've got to go to the rurals. These are not very complex people. Explain it to them in ways that they understand. Yeah.
My name is Bisi Adeyemi. I'm the managing director of DCSL Corporate Services. I think it's been a wonderful conference so far. I wish it had been better attended. But that also speaks to how important, you know, we take these things. Sometimes you would imagine that if we're talking about issues of sustainability and corporate governance, people will pay more attention. But the quality of discussions, particularly at this first session, have been fantastic. I think there's a lot on the table. And I think that as the continent of Africa, we have to look inwards and begin to have our own homegrown governance as it is. We shouldn't take corporate governance hook, line, and sinker, as it has been practiced in other parts of the world. But that's not to say we should lower our standards, obviously. And then we should begin to try to integrate corporate governance into sustainability, because at the end of the day, you cannot have corporate governance for now. Businesses are built to endure. And so if corporate governance is taken as a box-ticking exercise where we just want to meet with what regulators are saying, then the sustainability part of it would be lost. You know, so really and truly, there has to be better integration between corporate governance and sustainability. And sustainability is not just about CSR, because people just assume that, oh, it's corporate social responsibility, but it's the sustainability of the entire business itself, you know, and how do we impact on the larger society? How do we impact on our environment? How do we as Africa, you know, get out of the trajectory of poverty and the implications of it to our teeming population? And like has been said by the keynote speakers, or one of them, it's no longer African rising, but an emerging Africa. We have actually risen, you know, and we're soaring, as it were. I think if we continue in the mode that we are in now, if we take these matters a bit more seriously than we tend to take them now, then I think we'll probably be teaching the rest of the world, because we have a lot to gain. We are at the stage of our development where a lot hinges on how well, how right we get it. So if we continue with the level of enthusiasm that we're going about it now, then obviously the sky is just a footstone, would achieve all our objectives, because corporate governance, sustainability are all linked eventually to governance at the top. You know, how we govern our societies, how we choose our leaders, both at the corporate level and at the level of nations as well.